Okay, let's talk about chapter 4, what we read yesterday independently. Avon's first day at school was a little rough. Think about when they pulled up. What made Avon realize instantly that she wasn't going to fit in her mind? Let's talk about when Avon was getting ready for school. She said she was all right, not that nervous, but what did she do that showed she was nervous before leaving her apartment? Let's talk about how we might have been feeling when we were reading. How did you feel when Avon walked into that new school and had to face all those things? All right, Op and I are ready to read chapter 5, so get your books ready. Right, Oppa? He doesn't seem too happy, but we are reading. Chapter 5. I'm sure a lot of people think it would be cool to live inside a theme park. And if that theme park was Disney World, I'm sure they would be right. Though I've never been there before. I imagine living in Stagecoach Pass is probably not a whole lot like living in Disney World. It's more like living in Disney Shantytown. We'd moved into this small apartment over the Stagecoach Pass Saloon and Steakhouse because running a theme park is apparently a 24-hour-a-day job. You never know when an ancient toilet might explode, hopefully not with someone on it. Or a kid might get bitten by a crazed bunny. Because the apartment is located right on top of the steakhouse, I can hear the noisy player piano in the bar every night as I fall asleep. The only main course options on the menu at the steakhouse are steak and a burger, both served with cowboy beans, cornbread, and coleslaw. For the adventurous, there is fried rattlesnake or Rocky Mountain oysters for appetizers. I tried the fried rattlesnake on my first day here, and I wasn't all that impressed. It pretty much just tasted like fried pieces of fried stuff. I didn't much care to try the Rocky Mountain oysters, though. I've had this long-standing rule of not eating private parts, and it's served me well so far. The Saloon and Steakhouse is the first wooden building you see when you enter Stagecoach Pass after parking in the giant dirt lot, which is only a quarter full on the busiest days. Next to the steakhouse is a shooting gallery where the fake guns have such poor aim that no one can hit the little bull's eyes attached to plastic cactuses. Wild-eyed Bill cowboy cutouts and stuffed patchy-haired bobcats. Across from the shooting gallery is a tiny museum and the main souvenir shop, which sells things like drink coasters and shot glasses with cactuses on them, lollipops with scorpions inside them. Yeah, like someone would eat that. And postcards of the Grand Canyon. I guess so people can pretend they visited the Grand Canyon instead of Stagecoach Pass? Not that I blame them. The main dirt road, surprisingly called Main Street, that runs through Stagecoach Pass, winds a corner after the shooting gallery, and there stands a theater that shows old black and white westerns all day long. Maybe like one person is always sitting in there, probably just to soak up the air conditioning. Next to the movie theater is a soda shop that sells old-fashioned candy and ice cream. It's run by a white-haired guy named Henry, who's worked there since Stagecoach Pass opened and who never gets anyone's order right. Ask for a single strawberry cone, and he gives you a triple chocolate. He's like 100 years old and completely senile, but he always remembers my name for some reason. I guess I'm pretty memorable. Must be the red hair. If you walk further down the dirt road, you'll find a jail. People can pay $10 to have someone arrested for reasons like eating their boogers and having bad breath. I already had Dad arrested for chronic farting, and I didn't have to pay for it either because my parents run the place, VIP here. I'm planning on having Mom arrested for being a yellow sissy Bridges. Across from the soda shop is a petting zoo with 3 goats, 2 sheep, 4 rabbits, 2 chickens, and spaghetti, an extremely old mutant llama with a giant tumor growing out of his head. The lady who runs the petting zoo, Denise, told my parents the tumor can't be removed because he's too old and any surgery could kill him. Poor Spaghetti. The kids are scared of him and prefer to pet the other animals, but Spaghetti and I have a special connection. Toward the back of Stagecoach Pass is a gold mine run by a cranky old man named Bob, who clearly hates children. When they ask him if the gold is real, he's supposed to tell them, "It's real Stagecoach Pass gold," with a cheesy southern accent. Instead, he usually says, in a mean-sounding Philadelphia accent, "It's real gold spray-painted rocks, genius." Or, "If it was real, do you think I'd be here letting you dig it up?" Or, simply, "Shut your pie hole." You can have your palm read by Madame Myrtle, the park psychic. She had a hard time figuring out my future, though. I asked her to read the bottom of my foot, but all she told me was that I had a lot of calluses and she liked my blue sparkly nail polish. The kids have the choice to ride either a 1,000-year-old donkey named Billy or a washed-up circle camel named Fred on the dirt trail that winds through the 10-acre piece of desert that sits behind Stagecoach Pass. The rest of Main Street is littered with empty buildings and storefronts that used to house things like a photography studio for taking old-fashioned portraits and a mechanical bull ride you could pay $5 to try. The mechanical bull still sits in the room, broken down and looking forlorn. I once walked through Stagecoach Pass and counted all the empty buildings. There are 17. More than the buildings in operation. When Stagecoach Pass opened 60 years ago, it was probably quite the tourist attraction, sitting way out in the middle of the desert. The city has caught up to it, though, and besides the patch of desert that sits behind it and the tiny border of desert that runs around it, it is completely surrounded by buildings and houses, a strange little time capsule in the middle of a big city. The first day of after school, I walked into the soda shop, stomping my dusty purple flats all the way in to try to bring them back to the right color. "Is there a marching band in here?" Henry called. "No," I frowned. "My shoes are all dirty." "That's the desert for you," Henry said. "What can I get you, little Avon?" "Just a single scoop of mint chip in a bowl, please." While I waited, I looked at the framed pictures of tarantulas lining one wall of the soda shop. "Someone must have really liked tarantulas to put all these pictures up," I said to Henry as he scooped up my ice cream. He laughed, Of course, you do, Avon. I don't know anything about tarantulas.
Henry chuckled and waved a hand at me like I was acting silly.
No, really. I've never even seen a tarantula before in my life, I said.
He just smiled and shook his head.
You can't fool me, Avon.
He handed me my ice cream, a double scoop of vanilla.
Oh, well.
I carefully picked up the paper bowl between my chin and shoulder. I walked out of the soda shop and sat in a rocking chair on the front porch to eat my vanilla, which I don't even like, ice cream. I dreaded going home and being subjected to more of the interrogation about my day Mom had started in the car. There simply wasn't anything to tell. After a few bites, I threw my ice cream in the trash. I had already explored most of the park, so I decided to make my way around the back of the soda shop and see what was behind the buildings. I found a narrow dirt, of course, trail that wound through the small strip of desert that surrounded Stagecoach Pass. I followed it until I came to a small building, more like a shack. It was at the very edge of the property, which was bordered with a chain link fence. Behind the fence, I could see the back of the large grocery store Mom and I had already visited. I walked around the shack, noting the 7 "Do Not Enter" signs nailed to the outside. The old wooden doors had been padlocked, probably a very long time ago, because the metal handle on one had completely rotted off the wood, and the lock was still hanging with it on the other handle. I tried pushing on the handle with my side, but the door was so stiff I could barely move it. I needed someone's hands to pull it open. I peeked in one of the windows. Through the film of dirt, I could vaguely make out stacks of boxes and what looked like old props. Why on earth would someone padlock the doors and put 7 "Do Not Enter" signs on this building filled with nothing but junk? I had to get in there.
Let's talk about chapter 5, what we read together today. As Avon travels around the park, what do you notice about the buildings? Why do you think so many of those buildings are empty? What do you think about Avon's conversation with Henry? Why do you think that he thinks she likes tarantulas when she's never even seen tarantulas? What do you think is in that shed that Avon finds? Make a prediction. Okay, for book club today, Appa and I, right Appa? Oh, he vanished. Appa and I are assigning you to read the next chapter, chapter 6, on your own. As you're reading today, I want you to try to answer these questions, just in your mind. Question 1. At the beginning of the chapter, is Mom angry with Avon? If you were in charge of that park, would you fire Henry? Why or why not? Would you fire Bob? Why or why not? And what does it mean when Avon says that her parents trained her to be a problem solver? We'll talk tomorrow. Have a good day.